Hello, Quincy. My name is Eileen Fontenot, and I'm one of the librarians at the Thomas Crane Library. Today I'm with Sarah Hodge-Wetherbe, self-proclaimed geek gal, who will be speaking to us about the great TV and film franchise Star Trek and how it came to influence real-life science in the past, present, and future, correct?
That's it.
Yeah. She'll be speaking at the main library on Monday, August 19th, starting at 7 p.m. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here. It's so much fun.
Yeah, you're here for the third time, I think. So
I think so.
This is very great.
Fabulous.
So why don't you share with us, first off, how you became a Star Trek fan?
I wasn't around for the original run of the original Star Trek, but I was around for a lot of the stuff that came afterwards. So as a child, I used to watch not just the original Star Trek, but also a series that a lot of people forget even existed, Star Trek the Animated Series, which also was a late 70s addition to the Star Trek canon. And my dad used to watch it with me, so it was kind of a bonding thing with my father. And then when I was about maybe 7 or 8 years old, Springfield, Massachusetts, where I live and where I grew up, started doing something called WishCon, which was science fiction convention, but really a Star Trek con with a few kind of things tacked on the end. So we started attending that every year. And funny enough, that's also how I got into cosplay. It was my first, I went with my very first Star Trek uniform, which was, I believe, a pair of black sweatpants, a red sweatshirt that we sort of adapted at the top, and a little pin, you know, the whole thing. So I was very proud of that.
Of the original style?
Of the original style. And then later on, I went to some of the next gen stuff. But so anyway, so this was a huge part of my childhood. And then, of course, in the late 80s, 87, I believe, it was Star Trek The Next Generation came along. And so here is this whole new Star Trek show that I got to experience for the first time, you know, as it came out every week. And I was hooked. And followed that into Deep Space Nine and a little bit into Voyager. And I'm afraid by that point I was in college, so I didn't get a chance to follow the shows as loyally as I had in the past. No, but I still picked them up here and there.
A little Enterprise here and there.
But it's really one of the very first, it's one of the very first fandoms, geek fandoms, that I was really heavily into, and it sort of opened the door into a lot of the other fandoms that I got into later on. So it's one of my very first loves.
Very, very first.
Yeah.
What are some of the other ones? I'm just curious about, you know, what are your other big fandoms?
Oh, good Lord.
We only have 10 minutes, sorry.
I know, I gotta keep it short. I have lots of things. Science fiction in general, of course, I was very heavily into a lot of science fiction literature that kind of got me into other shows. Obviously, being born in 1977, Star Wars also. I'm one of those rare fans that Star Trek and Star Wars both have a place in my heart, so there's no war. They live together in peace.
Beautiful.
Obviously, comic book fandom. I'm a huge DC and Marvel and some other fans. But just sort of geek fandom in general. I like a lot of fantasy, steampunk, all of that kind of stuff, but all of it more or less came out of my love of Star Trek.
That's nice. I totally understand. I'm the same age as you, and my mother and I watched it together, I relate to a lot of this. So, but what inspired you to create this presentation that you're going to share with us?
So one of the things that I really loved about Star Trek as a kid was that I was very science-minded. I was fascinated by science. In fact, when I was a very young girl, I really wanted to be an astronaut. Unfortunately, the Challenger disaster happened when I was pretty young, and that kind of steered me away from that particular career, unfortunately. But I was fascinated by science in general, and anything that had to do with space or space travel. That just seemed so fascinating. Just the idea that someday we might be able to go forward and find all these new places. I think to some extent it has some of the same appeal as looking at the history of America, where we sort of expanded out into the West, you know, the same sort of adventurous appeal to it. But so I found all of the science fascinating. And funny enough, as I was kind of looking at science and learning about science, while obviously Star Trek is very fantastical, there'd be little things here or there, and I'd go, oh, wait, that's an actual theory. I know what that is. So it was these interesting little Easter eggs all over the place, where if you kind of knew some about it, you would say, oh, I totally get what they're referring there. Or they changed that a little bit, but I get what that's based off of. So I was just fascinated by it. And then, of course, many, many years later, I started touring around and doing all these sort of geek lectures on all these topics. And as a librarian by trade, you know, anytime you get interested in something, it's a rabbit hole of, I need to get all the information, let's see what that is. So I thought it was a fascinating topic, and I decided it would be a lot of fun to be able to do a presentation and maybe hopefully fire up some other people that were fans about finding out more about the science behind the fantasy.
Definitely. So you did a lot of hardcore science research that kind of tied it together with the fun fantasy part of it?
I did. So a lot of my research was book and sort of, you know, resource online resource-based, although I am fortunate enough in Springfield to have some patrons that are local college professors and things like that, though I'm fairly friendly with, so I would say, like, oh, hey, I'm looking at this, and, like, what do you think about this? Have you ever seen this in Star Trek? And funny enough, a lot of science people are Star Trek geeks. It kind of goes hand in hand. So we had these really great conversations. So while a lot of it was sort of what I like to call armchair scholar, you know, kind of, I was able to make some connections with some people in the field in various ways and sort of talk to them about it. So it was kind of an interesting blend of a lot of things, but it was fun. I got to put some of my librarian skills figuring out how to do it.
So what's your favorite, like, science-y thing that Star Trek kind of, you know, brought to the forefront?
So that is such a tricky thing. It's both the fact that science itself inspired Star Trek, but that Star Trek also has inspired science. So there are scientists, astronauts, other people who grew up watching Star Trek, and that inspired them to get into the field. If I would say, you know, my favorite sort of, I mean, it's obviously kind of fun with, you know, smart devices. You have your cell phone, you have your tablet, and you go, ooh, I remember Hard pulling that up and going, well, the data pad says this data, you know, that kind of thing. So that is great. That's kind of fun to be able to do that. But I think probably my ultimate favorite one that I found in the research is there's an entire group of research going on right now with devices that are partially on the outside of the body, but also partially wired into the brain for people who may be sight impaired or blind to be able to see on some level. And while it's very primitive right now, they have done some really interesting things with that technology. And of course, that's Geordie LaForge. And LeVar Burton being a librarian, reading Rainbow, all of that. You know, he was one of the touchstone Star Trek characters.
Kind of like the cochlear implants.
So it's this very interesting, like, oh, there's a really, like, a very real world application. And then, of course, there's some really out there, like, they're working on some theories that maybe warp drive could actually work in certain situations. You know, maybe not, but there's some ideas that might. So then there's some really out there theories that are really fun to chase down.
I think I read somewhere that maybe that there wasn't any possibility of doing, like, the beaming, you know? I wish I wanted to be beaming.
Well, you know, funny enough, I do talk about the transporters a little bit, and there is there's some sort of quantum physics, quantum level stuff that they know for a fact has worked. They've actually moved particles around that way. Now, we're also talking about particles, like subatomic particles. So there's a big difference between getting a teeny, teeny subatomic particle to move than saying, like, I'm actually going to reconstruct you and put you across the room. So those are very, very different levels. But there is a lot of really interesting sort of tie-ins that way. Tractor beam technology, same thing. They don't have anything that could move the fireplace across the room, but they do have something that can move atoms around a little bit, you know, using light and some other things. So it's interesting. Sometimes it's just sometimes on a much different level than what we think of the technology being applied to. But I mean, I don't suspect we're going to have teleporters anytime soon, but who knows? You know, I'm sure if you told someone in the 1800s about the internet, they would have thought you were absolutely crazy.
Like, so you're crazy.
You're very, very, you know, we have a nice room in the, in the mental institution for you.
I'm a huge fan of Star Trek, and I just can't, you know, think about all the things that is possible, and I surely hope that it does become possible. I'm sure we won't be around, but, you know, maybe.
Well, you say that, but we have been. I mean, again, you know, I talk about this in the panel, but even watching sort of Picard with the tablets, with the data pads, and less than 15 years later, everyone's got one in their backpack. I mean, it's technology is developing a lot faster than it used to. I mean, we know that for a fact, and it's very interesting to see where it's going. It may not be that, but it may be something else that we never even remotely thought would be possible that Star Trek's
so
introduced.
Cool. And one final question. Who is your favorite Star Trek character and why? Only one.
I know. So you've asked me this a little bit ahead of time to be prepared to break the magic of television. So that's an extremely hard question to answer. But if I absolutely have no choice but to narrow it down to one, I have to say it was probably Uhura. Because as a very young girl, seeing not just a female character on Star Trek, but a very respected character, someone that has a lot of clout in the actual show, and particularly a woman of color, which I thought was wonderful. She looked like friends of mine. And so on that level, it was like, oh, there's someone who's kind of like me and kind of like the people I know, and the future is very different. You know, at that point, especially in the early 80s, you just didn't see that. I mean, a lot of the cartoons I grew up on, action cartoons, you almost never saw women, and you really never saw women of color. So it was really this moment of like, ooh, the future could could be really different. Mm-hmm. I like this. Mm-hmm.
So I
think I would have to narrow it down. Plus the act, I mean, Nicole Nichols is just such an amazing actress altogether. Mm-hmm. I've been very fortunate to get a chance to meet her a few years back. Yes,
wow.
She was a lovely human being. We had a very nice conversation.
That's wonderful.
But yeah, so it was a combination of all of those things.
Oh, that's great.
But really, I could sit here and tell you about
but I'll wrap it up and thank you for stopping by.
Thank you.
Sarah will be presenting again on 7 p.m. Monday, August 19th at the main library, and I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm so glad to be here.
Yeah.